Hello, and welcome to this introduction to the ARM Embed platform and to the world of microcontrollers in general. My name is Renato Grottesi and I work in the software GPU team of the ARM office in Trondheim. The slides for this presentation are available at the address on the top right and the source code in my GitHub repository. All links are available in the video description. Let's start discussing why it's important to learn how to use microcontrollers. The first advantage of using microcontrollers is that they use very little power, so they can run on small batteries or solar power for a very long time. They are also very small and don't need active cooling, so they can be used in many interesting scenarios like wearable electronics, drone control, implants and any sort of automation tasks. Finally, it's worth noting that gadgets with microcontrollers have higher selling values than a simple application on a phone that could do the same task. For example, look at MIDI controllers, gamepads, smartwatches, persistent vision displays, or Pokeball Plus for Pokemon Go. However, working with microcontrollers can be challenging due to their limits. As we'll see later in this course, writing performance firmware that fits in a few kilobytes of ROM and can execute in even fewer kilobytes of RAM can be quite difficult, but very rewarding. The most used feature of microcontrollers is the access to general purpose input-output pins. You can connect any kind of components to microcontroller, read signals from sensors, write digital or analog signals to actuators, and use digital protocols to drive other integrated circuits. Now let's take a look at the most common components that you can use with a microcontroller. The first category includes components to read user inputs. Buttons are the simplest. They use a single digital pin and they are either pressed or not. Keyboards are slightly more complicated as their keys are usually arranged in a matrix circuit where a signal is multiplexed in each row and each column is then sampled to check for key presses. In this way, one can read a full N by M keyboard using log2 of N plus log2 of M input-output pins. Joysticks and touchscreens take two analog signals for the X and Y that need to be read using some of the few analog input-output pins of the microcontroller, which has an internal analog-to-digital converter to digitalize the signals into bits. Rotary encoders, linear potentiometers and soft potentiometers are also using a single analog pin. The most common multimedia devices that you can hook to microcontrollers are microphone and piezos, which need a single analog I/O pin. If you want to read a camera, you may need a single analog pin if that's CAN-based, or a wall SPI I2C connection if they have an internal memory storing the wall image. Sensors are some of the most interesting components to read, and most of them require a single analog pin. There are sensors for almost anything, like light intensity, atmospheric pressure, weight, humidity, soil moisture, temperature, gravity, compass, current, air pollution chemicals, proximity, and many more. If you want your microcontroller to interact with the world, you can use different types of actuators. DC motors just spin, but you can control their speed using pulse width modulation in a single digital pin and use them in drones or cars. Servo motors can move in a range of usually 180 degrees, depending on the input pulse width modulation signal. They are very useful to articulate joints or robots. And when using servos, make sure to know the torque that your application needs. Stepper motors can move with a very specific amount of degrees when controlled with their 4 digital pin system. They are used in machines that need to move to a very specific position, like printers, vending machines, or disk controllers. Solenoids can be controlled with a single digital signal and they either retract or push a metal arm. If you ever played a pinball machine, they are full of those solenoids. Electromagnets are controlled by a single digital pin and they have various usages like locks or levitation systems. Relays are used to control high voltage by manipulating a switch with an electromagnet that is controlled by a low power voltage coming from an analog pin of a microcontroller. Another way that your microcontroller can interact with the world is from outputting multimedia signals. To output sound through a speaker or a piezo, you just need a single analog pin. But you may either use a single digital pin with pulse width modulation to make vintage music. You can control a single LED with a single digital pin, or you can use multiplexers to control an LED matrix in the same way that you read from a keyboard matrix circuit. When interacting with LCD or OLED displays, you probably need to set up a SPI or I2C connection. Finally, there are a lot of other components that are used to make the previous ones interact between them. Timers are used to float some work from the microcontroller, and they can control external components or send back interrupts to the microcontroller. Shift registers are used often together with analog-digital converters. Multiplexers allow you to expand the GPIO pinout by reading or writing at different time slices. Transistors are useful to control components with a higher voltage. Resistors can help limiting currents to components with a lower tolerance. Capacitors help stabilizing currents, and diodes help prevent current from flowing in the wrong direction. Flip-flops and memory can be used to buffer I/O. The list of components that are presented are the most common ones, but be aware that there are plenty more to use with your microcontroller. And now a few warnings so that you don't end up frying some of them. While microcontrollers usually work in the 3.3 or 5 volt range, components can work at any range. Match the proper voltages using transistors or relay to scale up, and voltage dividers that you can implement with a few resistors to scale down the voltage. Also, remember to make use of resistors to limit currents, since some components like LEDs can burn if the current is too high. Some microcontrollers are tolerant to high voltages if you set the pins to open drain, so please learn about that configuration and the pull-up and pull-down ones. And finally, remember to connect all the grounds of your components together when using different power supplies, or you will get into very inexplicable behaviors.